Welcome to another episode of Conversation Cocktails with your host, me, Lenny B. In this episode, we sat down and spoke to Kevin Smith and Chucky Brown. This is the first time I did two guests at one time, and it was fairly interesting. This was totally a conversation and cocktails in its truest form. We were kind of whacked, to be really honest with you. A lot of talking, a lot of fun. Kevin comes from the band Fahrenheit 451, as well as another band, Another Distraction. And Chucky Brown is a musician who's played in bands such as Abject and also has his own YouTube channel, Chucky Brown's Hood TV. So, again, sat down and we let the debauchery roll. So, let's roll that fucking footage. Today we're talking to Kevin Smith from Fahrenheit, Another Distraction, and Chucky Brown from Chucky Brown Hood TV. So guys, what's going on?
Chilling, baby.
Yeah, chilling.
Just getting our drink on.
Yep.
Yeah, the three of us exactly. The three of us are actually in a band together with Jason Madrock from Down and Low.
Yep.
We just had our first practice, and I think it went rather well.
Yes, sir. I would say so, definitely. Band was tight, music was coming on. It's heading in a good direction.
No doubt.
Everything is coming together. Straight man's butt cheeks.
Normally, I wouldn't do one of these, check me out band things, but, I think both of you have enough to say, so it really doesn't really fucking matter at this point. Chucky, I have to know, you once told me that you think that the punk scene gets more love than the hardcore scene.
Yeah, man. I think it's because almost like every other weekend, there's always a punk show.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Whether if it's in Queens or in Manhattan or Bronx, within the five boroughs, there's always a punk show. You know what I mean? And sometimes they will mix it up with either with metal bands or sometimes with even hardcore band. But the main thing, there's always a punk show.
What do you think the difference is between like the punk shows and the hardcore shows? Why do you think there's more love in the punk scene?
Maybe because there's more punk bands in New York and whatnot, maybe. You know what I mean? And the people that do book it, either if they're not in the band, most of the people that they're cool with are in bands, and those bands would be punk bands. You know what I mean?
I would also say that punk bands also still keep it DIY.
Yeah, absolutely.
They don't do the whole internet really thing.
Absolutely.
Flyers, they go, it's word of mouth. It's,
yeah.
Kind of the old school way, like, yo, we're going to so-and-so's basement to play.
100%.
If I may, the one thing about punk kids is that there's a passion there that lies within punk music that, it's not that hardcore lacks it, but there's just a certain type of passion for punk music that at times I've seen lack in the hardcore scene. The hardcore scene has its built-in following, and it always will.
Yes.
There's people that are passionate about hardcore, that they are down for their scene. They live, breathe, and die their shows, but there's a certain X factor to punk shows and punk bands that you will not find in the hardcore scene.
No doubt.
And it's not a knock against the hardcore scene. It's two different scenes. It's just that there's just something there that at times you won't find.
Like, I remember when I was young, you would go to shows, there would be a mix of, like, metal, punk, hardcore, and even oi. It would be a mix of everything. But now, with, clicks and shit like that, now everything's, all different or whatever, but punk is always there. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, the thing is, punk has always been a type of scene where anybody was welcome. And hardcore was like that. When I came into it, because I came in through it through these guys in Fahrenheit.
Right.
And when I came in the very late 90s. We're talking 98, 99, 2000.
No. You're talking 95.
Well, 95. But 95. I was sort of an outsider still, but I didn't really, really jump in up until that point. And it just seems like punk shows, they're more inclusive. Hardcore shows, you have a certain type of feel and style to them that you're not going to find in punk shows,
Right.
Whereas hardcore shows, you've got your certain type of scene kids, you've got your certain type of crowd. Punk shows, it's just always felt like it was more inclusive.
Yeah.
And there was something that happened to hardcore where it went and it veered in a certain direction. And you can account for this where it went in a certain direction. And when it went in that direction, it left a certain type of people out that didn't feel included. And I don't know in the long run if it hurt hardcore,
right,
if it helped it or not, but there was a certain group of people that were left out. Whereas punk, it's always been exclusive. It's always been show up, have fun, and get into the band and do what's going on. Whereas hardcore, it was, after a while, it seemed like it was geared towards a certain type of crowd.
Yeah, I agree.
It seemed like. But that's just, you know, me and my viewings on my perspective on it.
All right. Well, I have actually two bass players here right now, which is one of those things I very rarely have.
It's like a unicorn and shit, right?
It is. It's fucking big. It's a Bigfoot sighting. Like, between the both of you, because you played in Blackout. You played, well, I'm gonna be a fucking dick. You played Sadness.
Oh, you're taking it back.
Yeah, I'm
actually, I didn't play in Blackout. I played in during that time. I played in a punk band called The Wasted.
Oh, I remember The Wasted. I remember. I had an ex-girlfriend who was into The Wasted, actually.
And at that point, you know, we were all fucking doing our own things. And back in the early 90s, well, the mid 90s at least, like, what did you experience playing in that band?
Well, during the time in The Wasted, although we were a punk band, we would play with a different types of with different bands, mostly punk, if not punk, then hardcore. And during that time, back in the, I'd say, mid 90s, it was a whole different, you know, it was a whole different era, because at that time you had like the skaters, the backpackers, the whole, even though the youth crew kids. And the whole beat down shit with bands like Bulldoze and stuff like that. Hardcore was going in different directions. Even with the post-hardcore stuff. You had bands like you guys with Fahrenheit, Shift, and stuff like that. So you had hardcore that was going in different directions, but everyone digged it. You know what I'm saying? Everyone was into it, including myself.
That was the cool thing about hardcore at that point in that era, is that hardcore wasn't just a certain type of a genre. It was a genre that veered in many different directions that now, for some reason, and I don't know if it's lack of bands, lack of players, or just the certain taste of where it's headed, back then it was more diverse. You had different types of bands playing different types of music. You had your H2Os. You had your 25 to Life's when we were playing.
Yeah, your Biohazards.
You had your Biohazards. You had your Mad Balls, your VODs. It was all hardcore, but it was geared towards different things. You had it was almost like hardcore had many different faces. You get what I'm saying? Yeah. It was like you could go to a hardcore show, and it could be metal geared towards more metal. You could go to a hardcore show, it was more, typical hardcore, you know, mosh part, fast part, mash part, fast part. And you could go towards more where it was like the Burn, Shift, Shelter type of crowd. It was very diverse.
And people would show up at shows. People would support it, buy merch. And, you know, like I said, it was a very diverse crowd. And people would actually show up to these shows. And at that time, it would be different because you didn't have no Facebook with the event pages, not even MySpace. Everything would be word of mouth, if not physical flyers.
Yeah,
well, I mean, back then, not for nothing, I mean, you had to hand out flyers. I mean, that was a thing.
Absolutely.
I mean, the internet back then, it would take you like half an hour to download a fucking picture.
Yes, sir.
You know, and that was the thing. And actually, I'm going to take this thing down because... Oh, man.
Wow.
You know, because Chucky, your footage has appeared on...
Yes, sir.
Show right here. Like, this show right here, you know, that's you.
Yes, sir.
And that's us. And we all know those guys.
Sick of it all, yeah.
Sick of it all.
Godfathers.
Like, the Mullally shows, from what I remember, they were always free.
Mm-hmm. Shout out to Lou.
Old school Lou. They were always a free fucking show. Lou. You know, we always fucking
Everyone gave their all. I mean, it was very DIY.
Yes.
You know, because I remember me and Frank did a lot of, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? We just...
You guys did a lot of legwork. I'll say this. When I came into the band, I was new into the hardcore scene in general. I had known about it as an, not as an outsider, but as a spectator, a fan. I remember my first show was watching Without a Cause play, VOD, The Iceman, Close Call, which became District 9. And there was another band on that bill, and it was at Bond Street, a club that isn't around anymore. And Bond Street back then was a big deal. For those of us that were like to go to shows and wanted to see different bands, Bond Street was a venue which catered towards that type of crowd. I mean, you had your CBs, you had your Wetlands, you had your different other little clubs, ABC No Rio.
Yeah.
You had your different type. But Bond Street always seemed to have something going on. And I remember going to Bond Street and checking these guys out with Close Call, VOD, like I said, and those bands. And I just remember thinking, wow, that opened up a whole new world for me, that particular show.
Absolutely.
Where I was like, I didn't know this type of genre of music existed. It was like, wow, this is like within my city, within people that were like me. It wasn't like some rock star, like a metal band that I was used to seeing on MTV. These were people that lived in my city, people who lived in my city, people who breathed the same air that I did, rode the same subways, traversed the same streetways and
bands
pathways.
That, bands that would chill outside with their fans or with people, interact with them.
And that was a big thing because as a fan, you were used to seeing these bigger bands and they were almost untouchable, I guess is the word.
Yeah,
and these were guys who were, you could talk to them on a humane level, one-on-one, where you could say, man, you know, I really enjoyed you guys tonight. You guys are really good. And
and
talk
I would tell you, go fuck yourself.
Basically, yes. Yes.
I mean, well, here's the thing. The one thing I liked about Bond Street was, in all honesty, that it was a Saturday matinee, which meant to start at like 4 or 5, 6 o'clock, and went till about 9 or 10 o'clock, and you had enough time to go and, like, fuck around with, you know, the straight people.
Yeah.
You know, it was that's what it really was. You would fuck around with fucking people afterwards, whatever. But at that point, show's like $5-6.
Yeah.
And
$10, I think, is the most that I ever show.
$10.
Not even. $8.
I think at best.
Nikki Camp, always kept them pretty low. And Nikki Camp was a promoter. He ran Bond Street, but he was also a promoter of shows too at that point.
And Blackthorn after that.
Yeah, and Blackthorn. The thing with Bond Street, I always thought, was like, he kept it a fair price for the most part. I mean, you could go see Doggy Dog would pack like 250 people in a room that really shouldn't have 250 people in a fucking room.
But they fit in there.
Fit in there, and it was a whole other thing. It was like, you know, this is before they kind of got dissed, you know, Dog Bite Leeway and whatever. And, you know, Doggy Dog, for the most part, had that, all right, fine. They took off their influences, you know, and they did sound a little bit
leeway.
I mean, they were dope in their own way, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Being from New Jersey and whatnot, and maybe they were influenced from that. I mean, I was a fan.
I
was a fan too.
I thought they were great.
Especially having members of like, what was it?
Monkey Pop
and whatnot and stuff like that.
Well, the thing is that a lot of people that I guess sometimes forget is that bands have to evolve.
Yeah.
You have to evolve as a band. And I wonder sometimes if people understand that aspect of writing music.
Right.
I mean, you guys are all musicians. We're all musicians here. You have to evolve. I came from the school of music, was the first band that I ever heard was with Caesar from District 9, close call, I guess. The first band, I grew up with him. We went to school together, Sacred Heart, Caesar, what's up? The first band we ever heard together was Guns N' Roses. That was the band that got me into playing music. And then from there, we evolved into different things. And all music evolves. And I think that I wonder sometimes if that's something that people forget. That as a musician, you have to evolve. I was strictly into like Guns N' Roses, and then I got into the Misfits, and then I got into Sex Pistols, the Cardigans, the New York Dolls.
Right.
I got into a certain type of music, and then the moment I started hanging out with different people like Lenny, Frank, Armando, Ray, and different people that they introduced me to, I got into different bands. I got into The Burn. I got into the Orange 9. That first Orange 9 record, I'm going to say right now.
The Orange 9mm?
That first Orange 9 record changed my life.
Yes.
That EP and then the record that came out after that, I'm going to say that record was pure fucking genius. And I'm
Shout
not
out
sucking
to
anyone's
Shaka.
Dick. Yes, I'm not sucking anyone's dick on this, but that record, Lenny will tell you, we had that record
on blast. It
on
was
either, blast. It was
either, let me tell you, in the van, it was the Orange 9mm full length. Or it was Doxin M 2000. We would run that fucking thing like into the ground. And anyone who kind of knew us back then, I mean, me and Kevin don't smoke up anymore, but like
I wish.
Yeah, I wish.
Kevin get with SFT? Yeah.
No, me, Kevin.
Oh, not Kevin. That's a whole other story.
It's a common name.
It's a very common name, but. Like, there was a show that you posted up recently. Chucky has his own channel on YouTube, Chucky Brown Hood TV. And Chucky did me a big favor and he started transferring old VHS tapes to his
channel.
Thank
you, Chucky. Yes, thank you, Chucky.
You know, because
Chucky Hood TV, man. Check that shit out.
Check that shit
out. Like that page, baby. Word up.
Subscribe. And, like, I remember he put up a thing where he's like, you want me to put this up? I'm like, what up? And it was the New Paul's like hangout footage, and
yeah.
It was.
You guys can check that out now. By the
it
way,
it was pretty footage of us actually playing the gig, and he's like, "You guys are smoking weed in it," and I'm like, "Whatever." And like, I have nothing to hide. You know, I don't care. You know,
we were very open about our habits back then.
Yeah, back then, you know, we were into fucking smoking. We were into stiff and blow. We were just tripping on acid.
Tripping on acid, ecstasy.
Whatever it was.
Yeah.
And I remember watching it, and I think the count was during what we were watching, I was like, there was about 6 or 7 blunts rolled during that footage. And that, this is even
and that was just
played.
What was caught on film.
And that was caught on film, and this was nothing like out of the ordinary for people like us. You know, we would smoke like, you know, on an average day, we'd probably smoke like between like 8 to 10 blunts a day. And
yes.
Me and Kevin always say, we used to do drugs. Drugs never did us. You know, because, you know, it's just something we
there
did.
There was a lot of people who we knew that would fall into that pattern. And they would let the drugs do them. Now, when I say that, I mean that they allowed the drugs to take over their life. Now, I'm not glamorizing drugs in any way. People are going to do what they're going to want to do at the ending of the day. That is human nature.
Yeah.
But for us, and I think that this is something that a lot of people were lost on, is drugs was just a part of, and I mean drugs, when I mean drugs, I mean weed. That was what we mostly did back then. It was a mainstay of what our mindset and what our lifestyle was at that point in time.
Yes.
Everybody knew what we were about. We never hid it. We were never like, hey, we don't do that. No, we knew what we were about, and anyone that played with us knew what we were about, what we were doing, and who we were. We never hid it. We never tried to hide that from anybody. We were who we were, and I think that that helped us in a lot of ways because it helped a lot of people relate to us as a band and as people.
Right.
But in some aspects, there were people who didn't agree with that. I mean, you'll know, you can agree with this. There were people who didn't agree with that. There were people who weren't into that and people who felt like that was a lifestyle that they didn't choose. And by all means, that was completely 100% fine. I have plenty of straight edge friends and I supported what they did. And that was really cool. I completely admired that lifestyle.
Well,
but for us, we were who we were at the ending of the day. We never hit it, like I said.
There was a, although I have to fucking bring up this point.
And by the way, thank you to Lenny's wife, Michelle, for hooking up the drinks.
No diggity.
Thank you.
No, we do, baby.
There was a point I remember, especially with the Fahrenheit thing. Around 1998, we got into Ricky. Ricky was a codename for blow, cocaine, whatever you want to call it. You know, we got into that. And and there were certain members of the band who would bring down... I'm just going to blow up spots. Fuck it. Frank would bring down friends who we never saw before and never saw since. And he would be like, yo, hook these guys down. And we'd be rolling a blunt and be like, we'd get me and Kevin... We always, me and Kevin used to always start the blunts. You know, pass to the left.
Mostly me, I would roll them because I was the youngest member in the band. In case y'all didn't know.
And there's proof on video. Yeah. If you log on to my YouTube channel, subscribe, you'll be able to see that footage.
Yes. And I was the youngest member of the band, so I was always tasked with rolling blunts. These guys were veterans at that point. So they would come in and be like, hey, Kev, roll this. Hey, Kev, roll this. Hey, Kev, roll that, roll that. So I would roll it. And while we were rolling, well, I was rolling, they would come in and be like, yo, we got like this, and like, yo, we got that. And I'd be like, okay, so what do you want me to do with this? And they'd say, yo, just put it in there. So we would put it in there. And at that point, you know what I mean, what are you going to do? You're just going to roll with it.
Roll with it and have fun. Here's the thing, though. I remember it took a couple of shows where we, you know, someone brings a bunch of friends down.
Right.
And... we would, you know, I'd take a few tokes, you'd take a few tokes, and we'd pass it. By the time it got back around to the circle and it got back to me, I like, you know, I'm dealing with something like this big. I'm like, what the fuck am I supposed to do with this?
Puff, puff, pass!
Yeah, puff, puff, pass. There was no puff, puff, pass, and the thing would be wet at the end.
Especially smoking at Wetlands.
Yes.
Or Coney, the fucking cider.
Yeah.
And me and Kev had the bright idea, like, you know what? Fuck it. Let's start blowing the fucking weed. And we were getting blow for a decent fucking price at that point.
Yeah, we were.
And we, you know, me and Kev would fucking be like, fuck it, we're gonna lace the blunt. And we're not gonna tell anybody. We're not gonna tell a fucking soul about this, right? So we would leave like,
I'm sorry for those of us who we affected that didn't know.
Me and Kev would leave the first part of the blunt.
Now you know why you were bugging out.
Yeah. Me and Kev would leave the first, like, we knew, like, roughly, like, how much we were going to smoke. So we'd leave that first part clean.
Yeah.
Right?
We had
that. And so we were like, you know, I'd smoke, like, two or three fucking hits. Kev would smoke two or three hits. Now, at that point, when we pass it to the fucking left, all of a sudden, everyone's smoking fucking, basically doing crack at that point.
Which was, I'll admit it. Maybe it might have been wrong looking at it in hindsight.
Fuck.
But to be honest, it was like, if you were smoking with us at that point,
right,
you had to have knowing who we were, knowing what we were about. Because like I said, we never hid it. We never hid who we were. We never hid what we were about. We never tried to put on some front. You had to know, I'm sorry. You had to have known there was some other shit going on.
But, you know, regardless, you guys will go up on stage and fucking rip it. You know what I'm saying? And tear the fucking shit apart, bro. So, I mean, I'm a fan, so.
Well, you know what it was? I was, I can say this now, looking back on it years later. I was a fan of the band. I was in the band, obviously. But I was a fan of what we were writing and what we were doing. And it was odd because I joined a group of people who were already established, already who had a rep, already who were doing things in the scene of hardcore that people liked. I came in as a young kid and I kind of just took the ball and went running with it. Like, okay. I didn't try to say, hey, we shouldn't be doing this, hey, we shouldn't be doing that. I just ran with it. Why? Because... it fit who I was, and it fit where we were going, and I enjoyed it. Like I said, if you knew us, and I'm going to say this, because there's a couple of people who are mad, and you know who you are, you knew what we were about. So let's just get that straight, let's just get that real right now. You knew what we were about.
Well, let me ask you guys this, right? When, obviously, you're a bass player, I mean, obviously, now you're a singer, but... what, between the both of you, what was that thing that, who was that guy that, like, set you off to, like, I want to fucking play bass, you know?
Oh, man. Well, to me, being young was watching people like Cliff Burton from Metallica, Steve Harris from Iron Maiden, Dee Dee Verney from Overkill.
Dee Dee Verney, wow.
Even to cats like fucking Les Claypool from fucking Primus.
All great bass players.
Made me fucking get on fucking bass, flee from Chili Peppers, believe it or not, and just fucking go crazy and shit like that.
I would say for me, my first influence was, and to this day I still listen to his playing, honestly, Duff McKagan from fucking Guns N' Roses.
Yeah, he's
that guy, he was the first bass player that I heard that made the instrument, as an instrument, stand out. Everybody knows bass players follow what guitar players do, but he was somebody who made the instrument sonically stand out to me, to where I was like, wow, this is an instrument all onto itself, to where I could learn this and see a path. But obviously later on, as I knew these guys and I got into different music, into the hardcore scene, into punk scene, so I was like, wow, I got into guys like Sergio Vega from freaking Quicksand. That guy's a huge influence. Davide Gentile from the first Orange Land record. That guy is a fucking beast. He doesn't play bass anymore, at least from what I know. But that guy was a huge, I cannot even emphasize, a huge influence on my playing. Even today, I listen to that Orange Land record and I'm like, that's fucking pure genius.
It's funny because you mentioned Duff, and he started with hardcore punk. Mm-hmm. I think he was in a band called The Farts.
Yes.
If I'm not mistaken.
Yes, he was.
And this was even before the whole
Dave Grohl.
Hard rock and roll
with Dave
stuff
Grohl. He played with Dave Grohl, who's in Foo Fighters now.
No doubt.
Craig Satari.
Yeah.
Craig Satari. These were all guys that were in the scene. These were all guys who, they were hardcore guys. They did this, they played that. But they were somebody who, bass player-wise, set the instrument out to where you hear those Sick of It All records, those Quicksand records, that first Orange Nine record, and you're just like, holy crap. They set the instrument out and they separated it into its own thing, to where as a bass player, where you're like, holy crap, that's something that, like, even to this day now, I'm, you know, in the age that I'm at now, and I'm like, holy crap, I listen to those records and I'm like, what the fuck were they doing?
Even shout out to cats like Harley from Cro-Mags. I dug that. Even to cats like even Lemmy in Motorhead. That whole bass sound.
I'll even throw this out. Loki was my first hardcore bass player that I got into. Loki from
District 9.
District 9, who played in Close Call. I used to roadie for Loki. And he was the first bass player within the scene where I was just like, where I saw him playing, I was like, oh shit, I've got to do what that's. But that's being done, and holy crap, like that was one of my early templates as a bass player. And I got my first lesson as a bass player from Loki. EADG, every asshole does good. I'll never forget that shit. To this day, 20 plus years later, I will never forget him sitting down with me in Bronin's Music in the South Bronx. Every asshole does good. I will never forget that shit.
That's what's up.
Loki.
Alan, shut up.
I didn't say that shit, they did.
No, well, when I found out his name, I was like, wow, his name is really Alan?
But yeah, really? that was for me, that was my template right there. And to this day, still my template.
Okay, quick question.
Sure.
Being the fact that you guys played in Fahrenheit 451 together,
mm-hmm.
What's one of the craziest shit you guys have seen or have done while playing together?
When all these motherfuckers got fucking
when Mike brought that
up
out on stage
in Connecticut.
I got a story.
No.
me and Armando got arrested once.
We were on a tour
with Underdog. It was a 5-day tour, and in the middle of the tour we had a day off, so we were going to drop the van off and pick up another van so we wouldn't get charged a lot of money. And me and Armando spent the night in the tombs. And we're like, the whole time we're like, fuck, are we gonna make this gig? We got a gig up in like upstate New York or some shit, or Connecticut.
Now, can you say why you guys got locked up?
Yeah, because we got busted smoking weed. You know, I knew we were fucked because
I remember this, by the way.
It was November. I was in
shorts. What year span?
What
year?
98.
Okay.
Me and Armando, we were back in my building. We're smoking weed. We got down to about, it was a roach at that point. And a guy comes up and I look at his shoes. I knew we were fucked. He was like, you got the time? He's like, we're going to jail. I knew this. I was like, fuck, we're fucked. He's like, the time is, and he pulls out his DT badge. I'm like, fuck. He's like, get against the wall. Me and Armando get against the wall. Pats us down. They handcuff both of us. We go in the fucking van. They start looking for other people to fucking arrest. We drove around for about 2 hours. Went through the tombs, which was interesting.
Yeah.
To say the least. I just remember thinking, like, fuck, I have no idea on me. I'm in my shorts and t-shirt. I thought I was going right back the fuck upstairs. We get let out the next day about 9 a.m. We go home. We shower up. I don't think we slept. We pick up the next van. We go right back to fucking going to shows. Mondo sleeps. I go back to smoking weed. And, like, I just remember, I think we played a show with Underdog and Wide Awake at the Tune-In. And
that's New Haven, Connecticut?
Yes. Yep. Okay. And at the time, Kevin decides to take acid. Me and Armando decide to take ecstasy. And we're all drinking a fucking ton of water. We're fucking, like, bouncing all over the fucking place. My wife, who wasn't my wife at the time, comes in to say hello to us in the backstage area. I'm so fucking wrecked. At this point, I'm like, I'm stripped down to just my boxer shorts and a hat just like this. And she comes in, she says hello to Ray. She says hello to one or two other people. I'm on the couch where I'm like,
I was sitting next to him, by the way.
I'm like, if you're not in the band, get the fuck out. Because it was like, there had to be at least like,
he was pouring in sweat.
I'm sweating.
And he had the cab driver hat on, which is this hat right now, by the way.
Was this after the gig or?
It was after the gig.
No, it was the gray cabbie hat, the big old Irish cabbie hat.
He had
the
gray one, yes. He had a gray cabbie hat on.
And
I think he had the blonde fro at that time.
No, that was already gone by that point. Okay. But the point being was, I was so whacked out of my fucking mind, I just wanted to throw everyone out so I could smoke a blunt. You know, and that was what it was. I mean, because when we would play shows, you know, we'd roll a blunt up and it, you know, it would be like me and Kev, and then all of a sudden it'd be like 7 or 8 hangers on. That we really didn't know. You know, if it was someone we knew, yeah, sure.
Yeah.
You know, take a hit of this. And, yeah, I don't know, it was one of those things, you know, we were really protective about our drugs at that point.
Yeah, we were, because we were poor.
Yeah. Yeah.
We were a poor band, we were not a rich fucking band, so whatever drugs we did have in terms of weed or whatever, we kept pretty tight. And it isn't that we were trying to be assholes, it was just, we were poor.
No.
So we couldn't afford a lot back then. Everyone seemed to think we could afford a lot, but we couldn't. Everybody seems to think that because you're from the city and you could afford drugs, you could afford a ton of shit. No. We really couldn't.
No, we couldn't. Now, Chucky, with the Wasted, what did you guys wind up doing? Did you guys ever record?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we ended up recording a CD. I think we pulled a full-length CD on Dead Girl Records. We recorded it on Music Unlimited, which was a recording studio in the Bronx during that time and whatnot. Shout out to Adam, who used to run Bronx Underground at the time. He was our drummer and shit like that. But yeah, we most likely came out with a full-length CD. And we called it Nobody Likes Us.
Nobody Likes Us.
Yeah, man.
I mean, but you gotta remember, at that point, especially in the Bronx, there really was no place to play.
Yeah, man, absolutely.
I mean, you have, like, I brought this up to somebody not that long ago. We had the train depot.
Yeah.
Which was only open for about 6 months.
Yes.
And I don't even remember where the fuck that was.
That was in Williamsbridge Road, right off of Pelham Parkway.
Yep.
Well, fucking train was even, that had to be a walk
from the train. I think it was the 2 or 5 train.
Oh, fuck.
Not too far from Columbus High School. And believe it or not, I remember back in like 95, 96, I could be wrong, I don't know, I think 95-ish, I saw the thrash metal band Nuclear Assault and this band called The Organization, which had members of Death Angel.
Mm.
And they played at that show, and there must have been like maybe like 25 to 30 heads there, believe it or not. And shit like that. Cold Front played there. Murphy's Law played there. Out of Line. No Redeeming Social Value. Who else played? A bunch of local bands played there until they shut down due to noise complaint and whatnot.
Yeah, because at that point, the Bronx really never had a club. It was either Train Depot or one of those Mullally shows.
Yeah, and
that's the thing. It's like, and I've brought this up to somebody else at some point that, you know, I'll give props to Bronx Underground guys. I really will.
Shout out to Adam.
Shout out to fucking, what was the other guy? What's Lacey's husband's name?
Dave.
And they did a fantastic job, but those kids really didn't go to other shows.
They stuck
with that Bronx Underground thing, which I think was safe for them. But, you know, they did not really go to other shows. Maybe a handful of them did, but most of them would only go to Bronx Underground shows. And again, you know, God bless them. That was a fucking fantastic thing that they did for them. You know,
they didn't take off and run with it.
Nah.
But at the same time, you gotta think about it. You're talking about kids who come from, like, you know, Lehman High School.
Yeah.
You know, they're 14, 15, 16 years old.
Yeah.
You know, so for them to travel all the way down to Manhattan, and most of the shows are 18 plus and over.
Yes.
So, you know, you can understand why they wouldn't go to those types of shows. You know, you really, you know, I get it at this point, but those kids really didn't go to other shows outside of Bronx Underground shows. You know, I mean, God bless them. Those, like I said, the videos and whatever I've seen of those shows, I'm like, wow, there's like fucking 300 kids, 400 kids at this fucking show.
Yep.
You know, but again, they did not really support anything outside of that thing.
That scene.
Which
I was saying was earlier, it could help you or hurt you.
But at the same time, like a Bronx Underground, you know, it did wonder for a handful of fucking bands. It really did. You know, and I really wish the Bronx had more clubs. I mean, they had the Blue Frog for like a hot second. They had, you know, the Chippewa.
The Chippewa Club,
which was essentially a VFW hall.
Yeah.
And, you know, that was really it. That and the Mullally's thing, that was it for the Bronx, you know?
They had another club called the Tooth, something, the Bluetooth Inn.
Oh, no, no, that was in Yonkers.
The Smoky Tooth.
Smoky Tooth.
Shout out to Filthy Jim, James Caverly, a.k.a. Filthy Jim, and shout out to Joe Pryor, Smirks Incorporated.
They had that place, and then up in Yonkers, they also had the Lowdown.
That was in Mount Vernon.
Yeah, it was in Mount Vernon. Second of the Bronx, they did have, for about a year and change, they did have shows. And they got some, we actually wound up playing some cool shows up there. We did three or four shows up there. One was Murphy's Law, was it Life of Agony?
I was there.
And,
Noise of Brooklyn played.
You know, and to me, I was like, wow. I was like, you know, they're attracting, like,
They had an audience
up there, and it'd be like, again, 200-400 kids fucking in this little fucking shithole bar.
Yep. Yeah.
You know, and I remember, like, you know, the Life of Agony show was, like, really good, and the Murphy's Law show was fucking excellent. Some fucking girl got naked on stage, got a black eye. You know, a typical Murphy's Law show, Jimmy. You know, you guys just...
Shout out to Jimmy G.
But like I said, the Bronx was always like this stepchild for me. You know, because we had some, like, there was some really, like, cool bands. I mean, Fahrenheit, you know, three of the five members of that band, you know, hailed from the Bronx. You know, we had Close Call, District 9. You know, again, all those guys from the Boogie Down. You know, and then you had things like Kilowatts.
Oh, man. Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And then you had a lot of random bands. And, you know, down the road, like, you had Billy Club Sandwich. You know?
Billy Club
came out of the Boogie Down.
Irate.
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 Yeah.
And I always feel like the Bronx was a kind of a redheaded stepchild.
It was an untapped scene that unfortunately was never spotlighted.
Yeah.
The way that it should have been in terms of the way Manhattan was, Long Island to an extent, Northern Jersey to an extent.
Yeah.
It was an untapped scene that no one ever took advantage of and ran with it. And made it to where it was a part of the scene. Because they did put on shows, they did have clubs,
yeah.
They did have bands that came out of there, but it always seemed like those bands tried to break into a different segment of the scene.
Right.
Instead of just formulating and growing that Bronx scene and saying, hey, we're here, we're viable, let's add to what's going on. And grow the hardcore scene as a whole
right.
bigger.
Yeah, you're right.
And that, I think, is what hurt them, is that these people that were putting the shows together didn't say, hey, let's get bands from other scenes or from other places like Long Island, Manhattan, Northern Jersey,
right.
and put together a bill that could bring other people in from different areas and say, hey, you know, we've got something going on here too.
Yeah.
Let's add to what's already there. And I don't know if that was just maybe they didn't have the contacts, maybe they didn't have the people, maybe they didn't know the bands, but that was, to me, it always felt like there was something there
right.
that was never grown. That it could have been, and it could have added to the larger collective as a whole.
Yeah.
And made it bigger right. as a scene in general. But, you know, that's all, you know, here and say now, many years later on down the line. But I think that they could have taken that and added it and made it bigger. But, you know, it's one of those things to where looking back on it now, you can say, yeah, you know, they could have done that, they could have done this, they could have done that. But, you know, it's all hearsay now.
Yeah.
It's all hearsay now. And I wish they would have.
Yeah.
It could have grown the scene. It could have made it something bigger. It could have made it something more broader. For more people to get into, because you had people from the Bronx that were into all the bigger bands. You had people from the Bronx that were into the Sick of It Alls. They were into the Cro-Mags, the Leeways.
Yeah.
They were into all those bands, but they didn't have something of their own that right. was merged
yeah.
into the bigger collective as a hardcore. Because hardcore at that point, it was Manhattan.
Yes,
it was the CBs, it was the Wetlands, everything it was the Coney the Island. And they never branched out of that to merge into that, to tap into that Manhattan, Long Island, Northern Jersey scene to grow into their scene more.
Right.
And that, to me, always seemed like it was just like, wow, you know, you could do this and make it bigger and grow it and make it bigger than what it was. But they never did it. They never branched out. But, you know, years later... It is what it is.
So, Chucky, what made you want to start a YouTube channel? Because you've definitely brought attention to a lot of bands. And, I gave you a bunch of VHS tapes to transfer. And, you know, you put a bunch of Fahrenheit shows
yeah.
that, you know, there were only, to that point, there was only like 3 or 4 Fahrenheit shows on YouTube. What made you want to do it?
Well, ever since I was young, I started going to shows at like that young age of like 14. And when I was like 14, 15, I started recording a lot of these bands and whatnot. And made me want to do it. I had all these footage, you know, in the archives and whatnot. And I said to myself, you know what, let me put all this stuff out. You know, at that time, there was no cell phones
yeah.
or anything like that. So... when I would go to these shows to record bands and whatnot, I would have to pull out the old video camera
yeah.
with the video cassette and all that shit. Jumping on the train with a big ass fucking book bag with the video camera. And the video camera wasn't even mine. It was my mom Duke's and shit. So I would go out to these shows and document and record all these different bands, whether it was punk, metal, hardcore. And I had all these stuff in the archives. So I was like, you know what? Let me start out my own little thing and put all these footage that I've had you know, in the archives and shit. Let me pull this out and have people check it out and whatnot, you know?
Yeah, because, I mean, right now, the three of us plus Jason from Down Low are starting a band right now. And Jason had brought up to you, he's like, we've never met before. He's like, but, you know, he's like, you seem to be on all the shows that I'm at, you know, like recording, you know. You know, I've seen all your footage, and I was just like, well, yeah, he goes to, like, all the fucking shows, you know? Yeah. Like, you know, nowadays you're recording with your fucking cell phone, obviously. You know, but you're still, you know, at least, you know.
I try.
You try. Once or twice a week, there's a new thing on your channel. Yeah. And I'm like, you know, I watch, and I'm sure a bunch of other people watch. I'm like, okay, this is cool and shit, you know, it's fucking... You know, it's organic. You know, that's how I feel when I watch those, you know, when I watch your channel. It's like, again, like what I do here is it's organic. If people pick up on it, awesome. If they don't pick up on it, I really don't give a fuck. You know, this is, again, this is conversation, cocktails. We talk about fucking whatever it is we fucking talk about. You know, Kevin. You're currently in the armed forces, aren't you?
Yep.
You know?
Drastic change in lifestyle.
Now, what made you want to go there? I mean, I know, but...
They don't know.
They don't know.
I've always been the kind of person that's been... felt like... I always wanted to add to a larger thing. Add my piece or my views or my hard work, my ethic, whatever it is you want to call it, you're it. So something bigger than you, whether it was a band or a movement or whatever the case may be. And anybody knows that going from the hardcore scene and what we used to do, going to the armed forces is a drastic change in lifestyle. It went from me literally going from hanging out in Lenny's room and smoking weed and all these things and to going to literally just basic training where you're getting yelled at and spit on and all this other crap into doing and living a completely different lifestyle. So for me, it was just wanting to be a part of something bigger than myself. That's really what it's been. It's just been trying to be a part of history, whether it was within the music scene that we were in or anything else that I've ever done in my life. It's just trying to be on the ground level to something that was history making or something that was going on. That's really what it is. Just trying to be on the ground level to something that was happening that I could add my piece to, or when I'm on my deathbed and I'm looking at my kids and to my wife and saying, I saw this, I did this, I was a part of this, I helped this, I did that, and I did that. It's basically adding to something bigger than yourself, which is, if you think about it, being in a band really is the same thing. Mm-hmm. You're adding to a scene that's bigger than you, that who players came before you, bands came before you, bands will come after you, but you will always have your niche in that scene. Just like I will always have my niche and what I've done in my life, whether it's the scene of hardcore or anything else that I've ever done. It's always just been, what can I add to something to make it better than when I came into?
I don't know if you want to talk about this or not, because I still remember the phone call I got. Would you like to speak about your... what it's like to stuff somebody up.
I'll say this, to make it short, sweet, and to the point. It's not Call of Duty. It's not something to where it's glamorized. It's really not. Everybody that I've learned in my 13 years in, well, 13 years come July this year, everybody, whether it's male or female, is somebody's brother, somebody's son, somebody's father, somebody's uncle, whether it's American, European, Muslim, whatever. Everybody is somebody to somebody else. And that honestly is the basic truth to anything. I've never taken great, what's the word that I'm looking for? Accolades or anything into anything that I've done.
Right.
Have I been in a situation where I've had to take lives? Yes. Am I proud of it? No. But it's what I've had to do. Up until this point, that's gotten me here to where I am today. And it's something to where you have a lot of people that glamorize it. You got almost like Call of Duty where you get on and you're fucking,
you're
going out. And the thing that I find the funniest thing in the world is that everybody thinks that, like, you're going to go out and kill this Muslim terrorist or this Nazi or whatever the case is. And the thing is that it's really not like that. It's another human being. It's another person who, before you met at that point in time, that changed everything for you and that person, they were somebody else. They were a different person, a different being, a different a focal point in somebody else's life. They were a father, an uncle, a brother, a sister, a son, a nephew to somebody else. And it's sad that we live in a world that puts us in a position that I have to do what I have to do and other men and women have to do what they have to do. I'm not going to get into the politics of it.
No, of course not.
But at the ending of the day, I'll say this. I have to come home. Try to contribute to the greater good. Now, Lenny knows, I called you when I was in Iraq. We text, actually.
Yes.
When we were being bombed. I remember I was being mortared. And it's not as glamorous as people would make it seem. Being shot at and being bombed isn't... and I say the Call of Duty thing because that's what everybody can relate to. It's not a great thing. It's not a fun thing. You are literally scared for your life. Think of the one moment, if you've had that moment in your life where you're scared, and you're like, holy shit, I could actually not exist. I could perish at this point in my life, and everything that I've done ends right here. It's not fun. It's not something that I would take lightly. It's not even something that I would tell people when they say, hey, you know, I don't want to do that. Then I might recommend to you. You've got to have a strong freaking personality and stomach to deal with what I've done and even what I've even seen. We can talk about all day what I've done, but what I've seen is something much more than what I've done. And all I can say is that it's not easy. And that these are demons that I will deal with up until the day that, you know, I'm in the ground. And that will be the whole of my existence. That will be everything that I've done up until then. And I mean, like I said, you've been with me my whole adult life. So you know a lot of what I've been through.
There was one story. I don't know if you want to talk about it or not. It's humorous as far as war can be humorous. You could take that or leave that. You can leave me a thumbs down. I really don't give a fuck. This is real life. You went on a patrol, and you guys decided to play Slayer on the PA system of the Humvee. And you guys were, I don't know, you were about a few hundred yards off base, and you broke into a firefight. No one ever shut Angel of Death off on the fucking PA system. And the whole time, you guys are fucking taking lives and blowing up buildings while that Slayer record is playing. And I remember you say, dude, no one thought about shutting Angel of Death off. No one thought about shutting this record off, and the whole time there's a firefight, and you guys shot tow missiles into a building, the whole shebang, and it's like, you know, we never shut the record off. And I told Warren Lee this, who, Warren Lee is a good friend of ours.
Warren!
He has, he's been roading for Slayer for the last actually 17 years at this point.
I've been on it a while.
And he started, like, laughing. He's like, really, that, you guys... Kevin did that? I was like, yeah, like, let Tom and fucking Kerry know this, you know, and he's like, I will, you know. I mean, during that time, I was like, what were you thinking? Like, I mean, obviously the music became secondary. It was like a background noise because, you know, the noise, I'm sure, was fucking great when you're shooting fucking a few hundred rounds into a position. And then the backup comes up and shoots tow missiles into a fucking building, you know? I mean, what do you think about shit like that?
You don't have time to think.
Well, why did you fucking... Why were you guys going out playing a fucking Slayer record in the first fucking place?
Music, as everybody knows, is the background to people's lives.
Yeah.
No, music is the background to people's lives, especially for musicians, especially for people who love music. As people in the hardcore scene knows, you listen to music no matter what you do. No matter what job you're at, even if you're a barista at fucking Starbucks, at some point when nobody's there, you're going to listen to something.
Yeah.
You know, you're an iron worker. I'm sure there's been times when you've listened to music and you're like, I'm doing what I'm doing and I'm listening to music. I'm sure in your job, you listen to music of what you do. It's no different in the armed services. We listen to music as any other human being, as any other American or any other European or whatever people do. I'm sure people on the other side listen to whatever they listen to. But in terms of Slayer, in terms of hard music, it's one of those things where music becomes the soundtrack to your life. It becomes the thing that in the background removes you in a sense from what you're doing. I don't know if that makes sense to anybody, but it removes you from the situation that you are in. Okay. Knight Rider, by the way.
Knight Rider.
It makes you feel like you're cool and shit when you're driving.
Okay.
But music is the soundtrack to your life, and that sometimes when you're going through a situation, as many people do, they listen to music. If you're in a stressed out situation and you're like, holy fuck, I need to remove myself from what I am doing, you listen to music. Even if you can't remove yourself from the situation, which is my case, I couldn't.
Right.
Music becomes the background, which helps you deal with the stress of what you're listening to.
It was kind
of
what, like, the USO came around and about, is to try to get people to step away from the place that they were in and the style and the era that they were in at the time, to kind of pull back from that, to give them a little bit of entertainment, to let them realize that they are, you know, they're allowed to breathe every once in a while, and they're allowed to have fun, and that's the whole USO program.
Which is... And people don't realize that. I think sometimes people take music for granted, whether it's the hardcore scene, the punk scene. I think sometimes people take the metal scene, whatever scene you're into, people take it for granted and they don't realize how special music is and what it does for you as a person in terms of work, relationships, even life in general. I'll be the first to say it, music, whether I'm deployed or whether I'm here, how much it means to me as a person, or how much it means to anyone, even you, take the time to sit back and listen to the music that's gotten you through a hard part in life, or whatever the case may be, to where you were just going through a tough situation, and you turned on that record that did it for you. At that point, Slayer is what did it for us. Did it get us through that point? It was honestly maybe 20% of what got us through. Wanting to live is the other 80%.
So Chucky, you were in a band called Abject. And how did that go?
It went pretty good. We played shows with Wisdom and Chains, played shows with Sheer Terror, No Redeeming Social Value, Murphy's Law, been to Washington DC, what else? Played within all the five boroughs, Virginia, Baltimore. We had a good time, man. It was a good run.
You had a record out, which I actually heard. It's a good record. It was produced well. You know,
pretty much.
The songs were fun. They were catchy. And at this point, I remember when I handed off, for Chucky's channel, I handed off, he was like, well, you know, I could transfer shows over to DVD and make them digital.
Yes, sir.
And at some point, you and me were talking, I don't remember what it was about, but I was like, well, I was like, you do anything musically anymore? He's like, well, yeah, you know, I'm looking for guys, you know, and I was like, well, I ain't got shit to do. You know, which true. I mean, you know, I'm always, you know, I don't play as much as I used to by no stretch of the imagination. I come from doing like 100 shows a year to now. I do 2 shows a year. I'm fucking lucky. And you were like, well, I want to do an old school hardcore band. And I don't remember, but I think I wrote like fucking... I think I wrote the original 11 songs in about 3 weeks.
Yes, sir.
And it went from you playing bass to us finding a singer to you being the singer.
Yeah.
And now you're playing bass. You know, because it was just one of those situations where... I mean, anyone who's in a band knows that it's finding people who are available, finding yeah. people who share that same, like, passion.
Absolutely.
You know, and for me, this isn't about a popularity contest. It's not about, you know, whatever. It's just about going out there, playing. Whoever wants to fucking hear it, awesome. Whoever doesn't want to hear it, fuck them. Same thing with this fucking podcast, not podcast, but this vlog thing.
Vlog video.
Yeah. I'm not one of those guys that is looking for, like, hits. You know, it's gotten hits. I'm doing this because we're sitting down, we're talking. You know, we're drinking booze. We're doing what we want to do. And if people get it, great. If they don't get it, I don't really give a fuck. You know? And today we actually had our first band rehearsal as a band, you know, full 4 members. And I have to say, it really went well, you know, and, you know, hopefully maybe it'll be peppered in this interview. You'll see some footage, like, right now.
Look, are you fucking editing? I don't think so, buddy.
No, but you know what? You're going to put it in right
Now.
And anyway.
You're getting shit.
Your mother does shit. We deal with it. But, I mean, right now, as what we are doing, what do you expect out of this?
Well, being a fan, back in the day, being a fan of you guys.
Yeah.
Whether it was Without a Cause, Fahrenheit, and now actually playing with you guys is like, you know, I'm playing with guys that I used to listen to during my teenage era and shit like that. It's kind of like a dream come true in a way, you know what I'm saying? I mean, when I was young, I mean, ain't nothing in the world like playing with Quiet Riot and Twisted Sister and shit like that. And being the fact that during my teenage era, listening to Fahrenheit and shit like that and not playing with you guys is basically like a fucking dream come true and shit like that, so.
Well, we're no different than anybody else. I mean... You know, I look at it, especially with...
Fahrenheit wasn't that good.
We had a...
Dude, come on.
The thing with Fahrenheit is, we went out there, we played our shit. I mean, do we get ignored by certain people? Of course. We were never ones to suck a band's dick or suck a singer's dick. We went out there and we did our thing. Word. And that was the end of it. And... You know, for better or for worse, you know, some people have... I spoke to someone recently about this, and someone said to me, well, the people who really, like, loved you guys, and yeah. then some.
Right on.
You know, and I would rather have 100 people love me than 1,000 people jock me. Yeah. Because, you know, they're jocking me for the wrong fucking reason. Yep. 100 people who get the message, get the music.
Right.
Because, again, we never wrote music for other people. We wrote it because we liked, you know, we liked playing music. And right. it wasn't about, well, we're going to write music just because, well, we're going to write dance part and everyone's going to fucking flip out over this. It was like, we wrote it because we liked playing what we were playing. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's the same thing with this material. I mean, we're not sitting here. I mean, this point in the era, we're doing paint by numbers hardcore. It's something to do. It's fun. Mm-hmm. You know, if people get it, awesome. If they don't get it, I don't give a fuck. You know, there is no, you know, it's just me expressing myself. If they get it, great. If they don't get it, again, I'm not here to suck nobody's dick. I'm not here to suck nobody's in the scene's dick. Right. It just, that's the way it is.
But that's also the great part of hardcore.
Well, that's also people the wrong it, part of hardcore, though, too, at the same time, because, you know, again, and I've spoken about this with several people, and I feel that, you know, at this current stage of the game, that there's, I'm not going to mention bands' names, I say that all the time, but I'm not going to mention bands' names, but there's a few bands out there who people fucking love to death, and you go, where's the songs? Where are the songs in this fucking, you know, in your thing? It's like, I don't hear nothing catchy, I don't hear the hook. You know, you can have all the energy you want in the fucking world. And I'm not saying that we're writing songs with hooks. We're not. You know, we're doing what we want to do because it's fun. These bands are going out there and getting stroked by an audience because it's like oh, so-and-so band, they're fucking great. I think they're great live, but where's the songs?
Yeah.
You know, and these are bands that go on tour. These are bands that fucking, I guess, you know, quote-unquote, suck the right dick. Is that wrong for me to say? I don't really care. And I think, again, the internet has sort of, like, leveled that playing field where we don't see the cream rise to the top. It's like, whoever wants to fucking be known, you know, you get enough fucking people to fucking jock your shit online, all of a sudden, now you're playing these humongous fucking shows.
Word.
And there's a lot of bands like that right now.
Well, I think the problem is that people are following names now more than content.
Word.
Mm. You got a lot of great bands out there who are toiling around opening, who are playing second fiddle, who are probably, not even probably, but they are better than the headliners. And you've got this segment of kids who... Yeah, there was a cat that got mad apparently just now.
Yeah.
They jock that band because that's the band that's always in their face. Right. And I don't know if that's marketing, I don't know if that's Facebook.
You're right.
Excuse me, I don't know if it's whatever. But the band on the bill who should be getting the most attraction is the band who you dismiss. Whereas the band who you should dismiss is the band that's getting the most traction.
Right.
So to speak. So it's one of those things where exposure actually hurts the scene. Because at the ending of the day, people need to remember the scene is two things. It's the bands and it's the people. Word. It's the bands who make the music and it's the people who support these bands, who go to the shows, that spend their hard-earned money, who trek from 2-3 states over to see that one show, who, you know, they put their hard-earned, you know, whatever, into saying, hey, you know, let's rent the car and go out and see that show. Yeah. And sometimes they're being duped. And it's the honest truth. They're being duped into seeing a bill who, quite honestly, I'm just going to be flat out and say it because I've never hid who or what we were. Fucking sucks. I've seen bills where I'm just like, what the fuck is this? Where I'm like, the opening band should be the headliner. Word. And the headliner should be the opening band. And I'm like, where did things get twisted? But unfortunately, that's the world we live in. That's the shit sandwich that we all have to take a bite of. That's the shit sandwich that we all have to deal with. But at the ending of the day, you hope that the kids in the scene see through that nonsense and they're able to say, hey, you know, that band sucks. That band shouldn't be the opening band.
No,
we've played Bill's, the show with at CB's with that band from fucking California that was huge that we played on Super Bowl Sunday with.
Downset.
We played a CB show with Downset. I don't care not to fucking say the shit now, but we played a show at CB's with Downset where, God bless you guys, the New York hardcore scene came out and they fucking supported us. They came out, they fucking paid their hard-earned money, They came out, they fucking sang the songs out, they put their heart and soul into it. And guess what? When Downset came on, there was like 10 people left in CBs. Mm. That's a testament to the scene. That's a testament to say that there's a fucking bunch of fucking sucky fucking bands, but you've got that segment of people who believe in the scene. They believe in the bands. They believe in those bands who are at the bottom.
Right.
And they're trying to claw their way to the top. And they're going to support those bands because Downset, nothing against them, they're a good fucking band.
Right.
They're a good fucking band. They've put out some great fucking material.
Hell yeah.
But at the ending of the day, there were a band who came out and who had a certain attitude at that point to where they felt like they were putting on this thing to where they were better than everyone else. And I don't know if that was the case, but that's just my spiel on it. And the New York hardcore scene, these kids, these people, they said no as a collective. Our scene means more to us than this processed crap that they're putting towards us. Our scene, our people, our friends, our music, it means more to us than this crap that MTV was putting out at that point, this crap that this magazine was putting out. Our scene is more than this processed bullshit. And God bless you all. We loved you all for that. And it meant more to us at that point. Because I remember it was like a day after that we spoke about it to where we were like, holy shit, like 10 people stayed for Downset. And Downset had a record. They were on MTV at that point when we played that show.
Yeah.
And we were nobodies. We were nobodies in the fucking scene. We were just some band out of 50 fucking bands that somehow managed to fucking squeak on that bill that played, like, I believe you were, like, right before them.
Yeah, we were.
Yeah.
And everybody fucking came. They sung their hearts out. They poured their hearts and their souls out into that set.
Right.
And when Downset came on, they were like, peace, bitch. That's really what the fuck it was at the ending of the day. And I was amazed by that. That was the one point in where I was like, holy fuck, the New York hardcore scene is this living, breathing thing that takes care of its own.
Yeah, yeah.
That when an outside source comes in, they try to mooch and latch and feed off of that in a way that isn't going to help the scene, that they go, they revolt against that. Because if you think about it, that's really what it was. It was a revolt against the establishment. It was a revolt against what was being pushed as the cool band and the cool thing to do. And they said, no, we matter more.
Right.
Our scene matters more. Our bands, our people, our friends matter more than that contrived MTV processed crap that they were feeding everybody at that point mattered more.
Word up.
And it, to me, like I said, it's just a testament to the scene, to the kids, to the people, to everybody that was putting in. Like I said, like we all know, your hard-earned money, your distance and travel of getting to that show and then knowing you've got a three-hour ride back and you've got to be at work the next morning or whatever the case may be. It's a testament to you, not to us. We're a band. We're always, Fahrenheit was a band. It was going to play music regardless of anything, but the people made that. Mm. I mean, I don't know if people will get that, but they made that point in history. And believe it was, because that reverberated for like a year afterwards. People were talking about that in Effect Magazine, zine.
Yeah.
There were other zines that were going on at that point that they were like, holy fuck, Downset, a band from LA, which was huge at that point, came and played in New York and 10 people stayed. Whereas all the local bands, us and the two other openers that were on that bill, whoever you were. Yeah, there it is. Us, Cold Chamber, Home 33, and Tree. Our people stayed for us.
Shout out to Ryan.
Yeah, shout out to Ryan.
Yeah, Ryan. And when Downset came on, they left. If that's not a testament to the New York hardcore scene, as a general, then in the past and now, I don't know what is.
I mean, I remember a point where when Bronx bands will be brought up, Fahrenheit 451, whether it was punk, hardcore, or metal, Fahrenheit 451 was always brought up. in the conversation all the time.
Well, it's usually us in District 9.
Well, yeah.
You know, that, though, you know, and I'm not saying that neither one of us were, like, founders of a New York hardcore scene, because there were other bands. There were always other bands. You know, I mean, obviously now you have, you know, later on you had a Billy Club Sandwich.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know, and you had
Martin. An
shout out to Martin.
Yup, Martin.
You shout had out an to Glenn. And, but, you know, at that point, Bronx hardcore really was not on the map, so to speak.
Yeah, word up.
It was in his infancy.
Yeah, and, you know, not, I mean, now you have a few other bands now that have come out of that, you know, that borough. But, I don't know. I just don't think that they have that spirit that we had where, like, to me, it was us against the world. You know, because we really had a fight to go.
I'll tell you one thing. You guys were completely different from what other bands were doing, even from the Bronx.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You guys were, like, you had your fan that would listen to, like, let's say, Helmet. And you will have your friends that will listen to fucking, let's say, even Megadeth. Fuck it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? That will listen to fucking you guys. You know what I mean? Including myself. So.
Well, the thing was that we never played one style of music. And that helped us. That it opened us up to different crowds, different people that listen to different genres of music. But it hurt us because you couldn't pigeonhole us. Like, there's certain bands who... I'm not gonna name them now, but you can pigeonhole them into something. You can say, this is what they play.
Right.
And they're good at it. They're fucking amazing at it. No one may do it better than them. But we were, and I remember we had this conversation years and back ago. So where we were jack of all trades, but master of none.
Yeah.
We played music that we liked.
Yeah.
We played music according to the influences that at that point in time influenced. And we listened to everything. We listened from Spanish salsa music to Megadeth, the Metallicas, the Obituaries, the Sepulturas, to everything in between, to the Sick of It Alls, to the Madballs, to the VODs, to the H2Os. These are all bands that influenced us to write the things that we wrote that people enjoyed.
Yeah.
So it seemed like we always had a mixed crowd of people. We always had people who weren't into one style of music. Where if you had your typical show back in the day at Wetlands or CB's, it was always geared towards one type of crowd. And then you had us on that bill who could never pigeonhole us into anything. You never knew what we were.
Here's the thing, I've talked about this as well with some people, that there was a point in the 90s where you could have a mixed bill from the ground all the way up to the headliner, and it was completely different types of music, and it all made sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it could be a band that sounded a little bit different than the next band, where now it's the same band five bands up. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like the same fucking shit. And I feel that there's bands that have gotten very, you know, they don't want to go outside their box. You know, they want
to
stay.
And the thing is, they can. I've listened to certain records and certain bands, and I'm outside of the scene. I'm not somebody that goes to shows or anything like that. And it's not because I don't want to, just because honestly work keeps me out of it. But I still keep up on bands.
Right.
I still talk to people in bands. I still know people in bands. And you hear records now to where you ask yourself, you have the potential and the talent to do more.
Yeah, absolutely.
Why don't you do it?
Yeah.
And it's not a knock on the musicians. It's not a knock on anything like that. It's just, you guys are so good to make your little corner of hardcore good, or your little scene, or your little area, whether it's the South Bronx, Northern Manhattan, Southern Manhattan, Northern Jersey, Southern Jersey, Long Island, whatever the case may be, wherever this thing reaches, branch out. Don't be afraid to be different. Don't be afraid to, if that riff doesn't sound like the last record, don't be afraid to introduce it, because We never were. There was thousands of other bands that didn't adhere to one style of music. They just said, fuck it. A riff is a riff. A piece of music is a piece of music. It doesn't matter whether it fits this genre or it fits this scene. At the ending of the day, the music is music. You know what I mean? We all draw influences from something that's not within our scene anyway. I just flat out said one of my early influences was Guns N' Roses. That's not a hardcore band.
Yeah.
It's not a fucking typical NYHC hardcore band. By any means, it's not. I listen to Pearl Jam. I listen to Alice in Chains. I listen to the Meat Puppets. I listen to the Cardigans. I listen to the New York Dolls. Mm. There's so many fucking bands along the way that I listened to that had nothing to do with hardcore. Lenny has, a 3 gigabyte or 3 terabyte hard drive full of music where 90% of the music is not hardcore fucking related. But somehow, you're able to write music to where you can fit it into that. And I'm sure every person in every band, whether it's a Vinny Stigma, a Craig Satari, a Lou Kohler, a Toby, whoever, a Mike Fleischman from VOD, you guys are all, and people who've come subsequently since then, to where the music, you've got shit in your archives where I'm sure it's not hardcore related.
Word up.
It's music. It's straight up just music. So I would say open yourselves up to that. Let that be your guide. Don't just let it be fast part, mosh part, fast part, breakdown, fast part, typical song.
Typical shit.
Which is, I'm not gonna lie, and I don't care who says anything, I don't give a shit. That is the fucking recipe. And you know it. You've been in the shit longer than I have. You know it.
No.
Break away from the recipe. Do something different.
So, between the two of you, what do you hope to see in the future? Chucky.
In the future, now that I got this new band going on, this was something that I've been wanting to do for the longest, especially with musicians that I used to look up to back in the day, you know what I'm saying? And hopefully get this on and popping and something that I could also have fun with, you know what I mean? And take this somewhere where, other people can enjoy it and hear our stuff and shit and, take it from there, you know what I mean?
You.
I want to see, just like Chucky said, just to get out there, put our music out there to as many people as we can. But I want to see the hardcore scene as a whole grow into something to where when me and you were in it, it was. It was a diverse scene, different bands, different styles of music. I want to see hardcore branch out other than the typical norm of, of what it is, and it's nothing against the bands that are out now. It's just, you guys are capable of so much more. Just show it. Honestly, just fucking show it. You're all fucking musicians. Play like you are fucking musicians.
I mean, I have to say, right now we're doing, we're not really breaking any new ground. We're just doing a straight up 1982 hardcore band. But
taking it back to the roots.
It's for fun. You know, at the end of the day,
don't forget your roots.
You know, you can't forget the roots of everything. And we're doing it because we want to do it.
It's a tribute almost.
Could I write music that's a lot more fucking out there? Of course. Of course. But, you know, something, I always find myself coming full circle.
Mm.
You know, I always find myself, I'll break away from hardcore. I'll do something else.
But
I always come back. I always come back home. That's the thing. It's like, to me, it's like, I'm coming back home again. Let's do this. Let's do it right. If people dig it, awesome. I'm not doing this to impress nobody. I'm doing this to just have fun. I think same thing with you guys. We're doing this to,
no doubt,
you know, have fun. You know, it's like, people get it, they get it. They don't fucking listen. You know, I'm not going to get ashamed. I'm not here to fucking please everybody. At the end of the day, I'm just not.
Come check us out anyway.
Or check us out. Don't have a real band name yet, by the way. We were supposed to come up with that today, but we were so busy doing what we were doing that we, that conversation didn't come up. And plus, some of us were drinking, some of us were smoking, whatever. But yeah, I think, you know, check us out. There'll be links at some point to it. But yeah, I mean, as far as, again, the future of what you see other bands doing, do you hope that they take it further?
Yeah, absolutely. No doubt.
You know, I mean, I think, you know, we need a band sort of like what the Bad Brains did to take it outside the box
and just
like and run with it. You know, it's like, all right, well, we're gonna challenge everybody else, and I don't see that right now, unfortunately. I think I see a lot of bands that are doing the same old, same old. They're writing for people instead of writing for themselves. And is it a positive thing? Is it a negative thing? I don't know. You know, we'll see what the future holds for that. You know, I mean, there's still bands out there that are doing it, and they're doing it well.
Hell yeah.
You know, H2O still doing it well. You know,
Sick of It All is
still, on top of their game.
Whenever Murphy's Law puts out a fucking show, those guys are fucking on the money still.
Yeah, they're still, those guys are still on the money. And
then you got the newer crop of bands who are doing it. Wisdom and Chains, Joe from Southern New Jersey, who's got a t-shirt company. I forget the name of your company. I'm sorry, I'm a dick. I know. Joe Stanley. He's got a band going on in New Jersey right now. They're actually pretty freaking decent. I've heard some of their stuff. And crap, there goes my necklace. But there's bands out there that are doing it. And yeah, I know, right? And just all we can say is branch out. Do your thing.
Yeah, man.
Don't be afraid.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid to branch out and do something different.
With that being said, people, I think we had a very good conversation, and we definitely had our cocktails.
Thanks to Michelle for hooking these up.
Word up.
Word up.
Michelle got me
nice.
Yeah, bitches.
And Lenny's very squinty-eyed, so you know he's done.
Yeah, I've been done for a few hours now. I've been drinking since fucking noon. Figure that one out, guys. Guys, Chucky.
Yeah, man.
Pleasure. Kevin, always a pleasure. Peace.
Peace.
Peace.